Hello and welcome back to HGC Europe Cup number 2, day number 2. It's the semi-finals and finals here on Tuesday here in almost the middle of the week. And have we got some games for you? First series we're going to be watching is Team Zealot versus Polska Pamięta. Did I pronounce that correctly, Tetcher?
Pretty much perfectly, Pamięta. There's an N in there despite being no visible N in the actual word.
So you have to pronounce Polish. An N.
Pamięta. There's an N before the T for some reason, apparently.
There is
Pamięta.
One.
There is one.
You mean I should actually write it, or it's just
no,
pronounced?
No, it's pronounced, apparently. Hmm. Apparently that E adds an N on the end.
Pamięta. I didn't think we needed more cloaked characters to hear Heroes of the
Oh, this is true. But yes, it is going to be Zealots, who are so far, I think, undefeated. Have they dropped a map so far? Like, I know they're undefeated
no,
in games.
Never.
Yeah, so we have Team Zealot, who have never dropped a map, versus a team, out of all the teams in here, I would say it's either this one or more who have a good chance of taking them. This is a very well-named team, I would say. We have Mopsio, who was called out by Playing Ducks Nanda as probably being the player to watch in the entirety of the Open League. We have Shichel from the good old G2 days, insanely good player. Very, very solid-looking team.
Pochiboss, Gluehammer, he used to be an alternate, ETN Gluehammer, and Razuf. Wow, I know all five of these. That's a good sign, because we've got 10 good players in this lobby.
Indeed, very much so, and a very appropriate name for them.
Excellent.
Considering we remember all the players, the name translates to Poland Remembers. So, which is apparently a meme from Mopsio.
That's where, what this name means?
Yeah, Poland Remembers.
What do they remember?
It's from Mopsio, where basically he was traded out or basically kicked from GIZ back in the day, and the Polish community started putting that as a meme in the Russian community. So that's what, and so Poland remembers getting rid of the Polish player in the Russian team.
Okay, let's see.
Apparently, that's what Mopsio told me earlier today.
Let's see if he turns that memory into vengeance here for all his people.
We will see. Let's do it. Game number one, ladies and gentlemen, is going to be on Infernal Shrines. It's going to be best out of threes. We're going to be doing both semi-finals and the grand finals today for those delicious, delicious points.
Yeah.
And we've lost... Oh, it's Kits for Spectators, DC?
Yes. Yes, any member. It's lovely when you're hosting a custom lobby with some viewers and some observers. And there's
six
observer slots.
Yeah, I didn't know that was a thing. Yeah, well, they're just going anyway. You DC, you lose your spot.
There we go.
All right,
bad
let's do
for
this.
That viewer, but of course, feels good for us. They're going to be watching the stream instead.
Yep, we're starting off straight away. And same bad as before, going to be a Tyrael ban coming out from Team Polska Pamięta, who I think we should call just Team Polska.
Yeah, let's call them Polska. okay, so two of the shielders get removed right away. Tassadar. And Tyrael, they empower the popular melee assassin squadrons that get picked off on Infernal Shrines. Kerrigan.
Small heads up. I will cover the draft for a second. Apparently, the clean feed can hear us.
Oh.
So I'll leave that one to you for the moment, because Grubby is our master production person for the moment. Starting picks, like we said, Tassadar being banned out. He's been insanely popular even before his change and also after his change. So, very, very powerful hero, and he's actually being run with Archons a fair amount recently as well. And Tychus, just a safe first pick in general. And we also have ETC and Valor coming in from, that is going to be Team Zealot. Let's get very safe picks in general with Tassadar and Tyrael removed. That's two of Zealot's favorite heroes getting taken away.
I will fight my blades.
We have... Sonya being picked up. First time we've seen Sonya in terms of the HGC Open Division. And she has been changed recently. We were expecting to maybe see her yesterday, but it's taken a little bit of time for teams to get used to her. I was watching this team exactly, Polska Pamięta, running some scrims earlier. They did run the Sonya. It was quite effective. So we'll see if they can use it to as much effect in this particular game.
Yeah, I'm happy to see it coming out. Sonya was
indeed
so popular here for so long. The Misfits meta, beginning of last year, Sonya, Diablo, Rhaegar, and here she is again. She has gotten some buffs in a patch just a few days ago, where her Whirlwind talent and her Whirlwind baseline generates more healing.
Indeed. So that will likely be Szychu playing that, because once again we have lovely Polish names to pronounce. This is the one that foiled, Szychu is one that foiled me for about a year at the start of the main Heroes of the Storm.
You shouldn't be allowed to put those letters in that order.
Well, no, it's just, that's just how it's pronounced, but it took asking him in person and about him telling it to my face 12 times before I got it correct. But that is fine. Kerrigan being banned away, and I very much like this. In terms of solo shrine people, Sonya was always one of the most popular ones, fell out of favor a bit, and it was Kerrigan who was always dominant. Picking Sonya and then denying Kerrigan, you denied that solo shrine potential.
So back then we were saying Sonya counters Kerrigan. You've got the crowd control reduction on your Wrath of the Berserker, and then you turn around with a Furious Assault. You slam her into the ground. and yet it seems like they don't want to have to deal with that just yet, even though they've got Sonya. Things changed, I suppose.
This is true. Things do change. Arthas being picked up for Zealots here. We've seen it used to very good effect so far, but right now I'm wondering what hero they're giving to Athera Angel. I'd say probably the ETC. Like, ETC on for Athera, and I would assume Zarmany on that Arthas, as he seems more comfortable on it.
I think so, probably. Yesterday, Zarmany was playing so well with Arthas. He was landing all of his Howling Blasts, providing a lot of disruption, and staying alive through many of those fights. Oh, Ragnaros.
Behold, little Ragnaros.
Who would be playing Ragnaros?
Not Poik. Not Gran Paqueta.
Poik is Vala.
Yeah. So that basically leaves us with... If our predictions are correct, that leaves us with one option.
Shad.
Yeah. Which makes sense. Very much a hero that I think he can rock pretty well.
Okay,
he's very good at pretty much everything he picks up, but Shad has always been someone who excels on the alternative heroes, the Abathurs, the Vikings.
Yeah.
Ragnaros, I feel, a little bit fills into that... he fits into that category a little bit.
Yeah, he almost got categorized as a specialist, but then I suppose the Blizzard team was prepping him for release, and they're like, wow, he does too much damage, so let's just call him an assassin.
Seems legit. Zarya on the shields for the Sonya. That's going to make it very hard to take it down. And a Nubarak. I like that. Well, you have the triple tank here. None of them are full tanks, I would say. A Nubarak's sort of the most full tank out of all of them, but even he has a little bit of a lower health pool. So running it this way, you still get a lot of sustain. This is almost exactly the style that they were running in the scrims earlier. Just running with lots of lots of tankiness potential, and then Tychus in the background. So they seem to have their style.
Now, we talked about this a little bit yesterday. What is armor? 25 armor, 75 armor. It's the amount of percentage that you have in damage reduction, resistance, if you will, against all damage types, unless otherwise specified. A Nubarak can get up to 75 spell armor, which means that every point of health is worth 1.75 health. Now take Zarya's shields. When you give him those shields, and he has that kind of baseline resistance against magic, those shields are also exacerbated by the effect of armor. So I think Zarya and Nubarak is going to be a combination that we see more and more often. Everyone has spell damage, even the biggest auto attack. Okay, except Bladestorm. except Samuro, where Bladestorm is his only spell damage. But pretty much every character has a significant portion of spell damage, and this makes Nubarak virtually unkillable.
It's true, and especially Valor in this case, she got a large bit of AoE damage, which is especially useful on the shrines. We've been seeing a lot of Arsenal being picked up yesterday, which we haven't seen in a while, which is a little bit of extra spell damage on that multi-shot.
Well, let's see what everyone goes for. I like the draft here for the Polska boys. They have a triple warrior setup. Nubarak is already specking into damage and disabling the opponent's heroes. But let's introduce the heroes and the teams for today. Once again, we've got Team Zealot in the blue on the left, Shad on Ragnaros, Athero Angel on ETC, Poyok on Vala, Zarmany on Arthas, and Grand Paquette on Mouth.
Whereas on the right hand side, it is going to be Polska Pamięta, and starting the top lane, Szychu on Sonya, and Nubrak's going to be played by Mopsio in the bot lane, Potiboss playing the Zarya, Bluehammer on Tychus, and Zhuf on the dog, the Rhaegar.
Okay. We have a defensive setup here for the Polska players. They're wondering whether maybe there'll be a five-man attack somewhere. So they kind of spread out initially. Note, not a big five-man party for them in the middle. They have judged the team of Zealot to be more effective at winning a five versus five. And this is how it should be like. Oh, hold on, hold that thought. Power slide into Entangle. Rhaegar in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, Zuv taking a little bit of damage. Able to pull back. He will be able to heal himself quite quickly. But he is fine. He's lost half his health. But as long as he doesn't use too much of his mana on the healing before the actual objective, he should be fine.
People ask sometimes, why is it that at low level and at pro level, always there's a five versus five man party in the middle? Why do they always fight? And my answer is, it doesn't make sense. One of the teams must be overestimating themselves. Because if you look at a lineup and you have, let's say if you have perfect knowledge, you will know that one of those five members, one of those five-man teams is better than the other one at securing early game kills. And the one that's worse should not be taking that fight. And in this time, Polska has judged that to be the case, so they're kind of breaking up the composition here. And they're not losing much for it. The towers aren't getting a lot of damage.
Yeah, it seems to be, I agree with you, it seems to be an estimate, either an overestimate on the team comp or an overestimate of skill. Even yes. Like people thinking, oh, hang on, EZC, good start to a Nubarak. And this is the point in a Nubarak. Yes, he does have an incredible amount of CC, but he's not as tanky as some of the other tanks out there. And even with Azaria, unable to sustain his way through.
And moreover, he has not chosen Dampen Magic, something that really, really, really makes him very survivable. When you look at armor and you say, okay, you go from no armor to 25, that's a nice boost. But then when you go from 25 armor to 50, that is a much, much larger boost. I won't go exactly into the maths, but every single point of armor is worth more than the previous one, all the way until you reach the cap of 75. So Dampen Magic, so good. Instead, he's going for the greedy damage talent, so he's got to play it a bit more careful. He cannot be that face tanking warrior.
Yep, which is, like you said, he has to be a little bit more careful, but he does just have a huge amount of CC, which is going to help against heroes like Rag, who really rely on not being CC'd so they can get that Empower Sulfurous off.
And speaking of which, big triple hit here.
Going down yet. Blue Hammer. Oh, good start, actually. Onza Poik from above. Mopsio getting the kill. Beautifully played.
Very nice. The warrior that comes from an angle that is not easily seen is always going to have a better time ganking an assassin. Ragnaros, long distance, steals the shrine away. I mean, it was a situation of 37 skeletons versus 18, so no matter how many takedowns you get, Rag will splash that in a victory for his team.
Yep, he's beautifully done. It's just like, oh, we lost the objective. Nope, I'm Ragnaros. Zero caring is here. But this does give us time to look quickly at the talents, although the Punisher going to go down quickly, not going to get too much, we'll probably get both towers if they are quick enough. Blue Heaven going to try and prevent it, but no, tower will go down. But yeah, talents we see here, Under King, once again, more CC, the extra range and damage. Nubarak going very much for just sniping kills here. I am the strongest by Zarya, a huge amount of extra sustain she gets with that, and Hurricane on Sonya. Now, this is a beautiful talent here, not just because it actually removes the roots and the slows from Arthas and Malfurion, so perfect against those two, but it also does reduce the cooldown of Whirlwind by 1 second, which is something that's often overlooked with that talent, but makes it super good.
Yeah, I mean, there's only two interrupts here, maybe three, on the side of Team Zealot, and two of them are locked behind ultimate cooldowns, and for the rest, it's pretty much just Power Slide that can stop Whirlwind, so getting back with the program, starting to whirlwind again as fast as possible. It's really nice. And she can break out of the entangling roots as well as the howling tempest of Arthas. The frozen blast, remorseless winter, anything. Basically, all the things in this kit that's slow.
Very true. And Sonya's actually gone for what I would consider a standard build, but she's actually adjusted at level 1 with block. We'd sometimes see the, in fact, almost all the level 1 talents for Sonya are effective. Shot of Fury used to be the go-to with a lot of Whirlwind builds, because Whirlwind is an expensive ability, and Fury, if you're trying to wait for a frontline, is hard to get. But with triple frontlines coming in from Zealots, it's going to be a lot easier to get in range to get that Fury for the Whirlwind, so it's not as big of a deal. Instead, the block is going to prevent a lot of damage from basically all of the damage dealers on the side of Zealots, which means completely safe to go with that and reduce the amount of damage taken. And then it's Hurricane and the Ferocious Healing, just even more sustained for Shichu.
And Anubarak has gone for Leeching Scarabs at 7 there.
Ooh, but he didn't go for the swarm.
Yeah, I mean, there's two options there. He can get more carapace. Every time he takes points of spell damage, he gets a small cooldown reduction on the carapace. Or he can get the movement speed, shed exoskeleton, but he's decided to go with the leeching scarabs. A little bit more self-sustain after choosing fully greedy damage talents. Once again, coming in from the dark, bro charging in, getting an impale.
Wants to try and get Shad, but Shickle is instead changing the focus onto Zarmani. No armor will save him. He is taken out. Poik in full retreat as well. Once again, objective in full control of Team Polska Pienta. And we do see Rag. He does have, he does have Molten Core, but he's not currently positioned, and they don't even have enough skeletons to even attempt it.
Yeah, it looks like he was going to try and do a steal again, but he seemed to have changed his mind on the way there as he realized that is not a race that he can win. He'd rather have it in the defense here, and there we go, starting to clear those minions there. It helps to reduce a lot of the siege damage, kind of sprinkle the memories of Polski Pamięta with those spells and force them to go away. No fort damage will be done almost, just a little bit here at the tail end of that objective push.
Tiny little bit, and I will say Shad did something very, very clever there. He held back on his stun that he can do during Molten Core. Hang on, bit of CC onto Tychus, but Tychus actually just completely damaging out of their angel and forcing that retreat here. But this is some of the most pressure we have seen onto Zealots so far. We've seen a couple games which put him on the ropes, but so far this is really solid play by Polska.
Yeah, so far Team Zealot has never really been threatened. They've been behind the level or two levels in this week and the last 2 weeks, and when we saw cup number one, we've never really looked at them and say, oh my god, I think this is a game that they're losing. So far they are again a little bit behind. They've lost a few towers, a little bit of XP behind, but they always seem to rally, so Polska has to remain on their guard. I'm not gonna say that they should be careful or that they should play safe. That's not how you win cups, games, championships. You can't just go through games playing it safe. But you do need to play it competently and smart, and they know the best how they can do that. They're starting to take a camp here, providing a distraction point. Taking this one that's the furthest out of the way allows them to concentrate all their members for a potential invasion here of this impalers or this impalers here at the bottom. They don't need to go top anymore. And the timing of their capture is fairly useful. Sonya abandons top lane knowing that she pushed the lane fast, and it gives them the potential to do a 5-man collapse at the bottom. What I don't like is that Sonya is showing herself in the mid lane. It pretty much tells the story of exactly what they are capable of here.
Yeah, she also popped her heroic there, not able to get anything out of it. She's trying to position to grab someone, but everyone from there is playing too far back. Heroic-wise, they are available for both teams. We have Moshpit on ETC. He wants to get that huge lockdown. There's a hell of a lot of CC from the side of Polska here, but he can get it if he can lock down the correct heroes in general. Other talents worth talking about, Tranquility on Malfurion, which is a little bit weird because Silence is the only thing that isn't reduced by Wrath of the Berserker here, and Ancestral Healing as opposed to Bloodlust.
Yeah, I think the reasoning there is that you often take Tranquility against massive health pool teams, as even the quick burst of a Twilight Dream, the Silence will not kill them. Yes, they can't use abilities. Hold their thoughts. Fury Smash coming in here with the follow-up on the Power Slide.
The Ancestral does not land. We see immediately Zarya getting taken out. Mopsio being chased away. He has got Locust Swarm activated, which is helping him tank through this. Laser currently focusing minions, as the Arthas minions, as opposed to actual heroes. But right now, with Zarya already gone, this fight looks in complete control of Zealot, and they will get this objective.
Yeah, but I mean, just to finish the thought here, there's heroes that rely on certain abilities to save themselves, like Illidan. He needs evasion. He needs to be able to juke and jive. Warriors rely on health pools to save themselves. It makes Twilight Dream or Silence slightly less effective on them than on Assassins. So going for that quick burst and then realizing that you can't is not as good here on Malph as trying to out-sustain the more average damage that a Warrior puts out compared to, say, a Bursting Jaina or Zeratul or something like that.
Fair enough. Makes a lot of sense. Gonna see Zealots finally with first time they've had control in the game. Even though two different objectives have been taken by Team Polska here, they haven't been able to take a single fort, but Zealots on their very first one immediately wade through a fort here. And we're gonna see a quick clear up by Polska here. Also, no, sorry, this is their second objective. And they're actually going to grab another four in the top lane as well, putting some pressure onto that and killing that off easily. Zabli tanking through very nicely with the healing of Gran Paqueta, and they're able to zone out Mopsio to try and prevent a kill go for this. Gran Paqueta dodging out Schichel here, who's trying to spin through all of this damage. Expulsion zone is good, but it's not getting a huge amount of value here. The mosh pit grabbing pretty much everyone. It's not furious onto Sonya, who's still attempting to spin to keep herself alive. It's a good heal. She is surviving. Poik with the strafe in the background, trying to do a huge amount of damage. The Ragnaros doing some good damage as well, getting some good AoE. Zabali finally taken out. Schichel very low. It's a 1-for-1 here. Can anyone pick up a follow-up? Zealots continuing to push through because they have slightly more health. Sonya goes back in, gets the shield from Zarya.
The healing
trying
is
to get Poik. He gets CC'd. He dodges the root though. And the blast wave does not land, but Shad heals himself back to full. He's starting to run a bit lower mana. Gets stunned. Can they finish him off? Schichel's a bit low. He needs that whirlwind back off cooldown, which he does. He doesn't have the fury for it. And gets knocked back. Can they chase one more? It's currently a 2-for-1 in favor of Polska, and very greedy by Gloohammer, nearly getting punished for it.
Yeah,
but finally, Polska able to win the fight.
Greedy by Poik as well. He's literally 1v4 here, but he knows he's aware of the cooldowns that are available. He knows Impale is gone. He's even starting to work on the wall. But Tetra, what a big deal that this fountain was still here. They all went for a tap. There's almost nothing left here. A shambles of their fort of the past that used to be there. But the fountain is there. They take the healing. They re-engage. And that was such an enjoyable, delectable fight to watch here. Sonya self-sustained with Whirlwind, with the healing from Rezuf, Rhaegar, and Potiboss' Zarya was insane. They had a lot of damage, and they were able to actually get the 2-for-1 there.
Yeah, that was a really rough fight and a very long-lasting one. Both teams using the amount of sustain they got from the double tank plus Rag on the side of Zealots to the double tank plus Bruiser from the side of Polska, who are just putting up a great fight so far. Currently, they are ever so slightly ahead in XP, but not a significant amount yet.
Two forts down as well, one takedown up, which means they've been doing pretty good in the XP soaking department of the minions. Now, there is a problem here for Polska. They are under a threat of time pressure. Fallen Shaman is full HP and at the wall, and fast forward a minute and the wall will be gone. So they need to make this happen fast. Win or lose, they need this objective to be over pretty fast and expect them to make a move. They need to start Tranquility as well. They need to do an engage, start Tranquility, back off, and then re-engage. But it's not easy, because can you really give away the shrine for that long?
Noob is able to actually hold through the front line there without popping his heroic, which is a seriously big deal for him. There's a good start onto Sonya, who's cleansed through. Noob into the back line, distracting Gran Paqueta, zoning him out from any Tranquility. He's able to get Poik as well. The Sulfurous is huge, but Ancestral will keep Schichel alive. Poti able to shield himself as well. Zarmani getting shredded by Gloohammer. And ETC coming in to try and save. Moshpit is available here, but can he do anything with it? They're also split.
Very good Mopsio positioning there by staying that far ahead against ETC, basically hugging him. He prevents the mosh pit power slide combination there that could possibly happen. Now, of course, without Vala, it wouldn't really be enough damage anyway to burst everyone down, but it's still very heads up play there by Anubarak. Mopsio coming in again, once again, from the side with the burrow charge.
He's getting CC'd with the shield from Zarya, keeping him alive. He's used his heroic already. He does not have that for the sustain. He's getting focused down, gets knocked back, and Rag finishes him off. And that kill is good timing for Zealots. If they can defend the Punisher without losing anyone here, that's good. But the mosh pit lands on two heroes for support and the assassin here. Portimus trying to save everyone, but Rhaegar is rooted. He's taken out. Gloohammer trying to focus down Zarya, but he's rooted. The grenade gets the kill, though. But ETC with the stun, finishing him off. Sonya did survive this because she was not here. Zarya will go down thanks to Ragnaros. Sonya leaving her team, but as such, a team getting punished and killed off.
Yeah, I mean, the Fallen Shamans took down the wall. They were going to take more. Sonya went back to defend, which is heads up. And I think everything was pretty much okay. They got the fort. The Anubarak burrow charge even was kind of okay. But he stayed there as long as if it was actually a 5v4. He was taking a lot of damage, and I kept thinking, can he really? Has Anubarak lifted himself up to this point, where even though he drops to half-life, he's still not taking a single step back? And I think Mopsio overextended a little bit there. His loss, his death, led to the death of his teammates, and it evaporated whatever advantage Polska should have had here.
Yeah, he also doesn't have as many tank talents. He has the Leeching Scarabs, Locust Swarm, which was on cooldown, and he got Blood for Blood midst of that fight, which he used, but it wasn't enough to keep him alive, especially now that Ragnaros has Giant Scorcher, which is going to help him burn through these heroes even more effectively.
Yeah, of course, Anubarak has two self-sustained talents at tiers where he can. At level 7, it's actually always some form of self-sustain. 16 is an option, though, so he's gone for safety there. And the primary part of his kit is a very long impale that also slows and damages and leaves behind spikes that will slow and damage people that walk over it for 3.5 seconds. So that is pretty nice. Mopsio now in the front. Scary fight here. Nice impale interrupting the power slide there.
Zulfurus does land, but it was cleansed out. Schickle tanking through. Schickle has yet to die yet this game. Lots of damage coming onto it, which is building a huge amount of energy onto Porti. He's beginning to harass back with the grenades. Mopsio getting the stun onto Arthas. Arthas seems to be the target in a lot of these fights, but they're unable to get him. Schickle rooted again. Whirlwind is available, but he's holding it. He does not need it yet. Now he's dropping it just to make sure he gets that extra movement speed to escape here. Another root landing, and Anubarak so out of position here. They're coming into the backline though, they want something. Get the two-man knockup by Anub. They're going for Ragnaros here, and Sonya spinning through the fight. Tranquility is dropped. EDC, Mosh pitting in the background, only getting Zarya, who's getting focused down. Juve continuing to be healing him up. Mopsio is focused down, doesn't get any sustain for himself here. Jekyll trying to spin to keep himself alive. The expulsion zone zones them out. Laser tried to kill Zarmany, but it's killed off. Ancestral keeps Jekyll alive, and that will be a disengage coming in from Zealots, but Gloomhammer wants to punish it, and he gets a Thero.
Wow, he gets a Thero with that bonus run and gun range, press the advantage. I was looking at the entire fight here at Rezuf. He was thinking hard, who do I ancestral heal? He tried to keep his positioning as safe as possible and keeps looking at different targets. And I feel like Team Zealot was playing to ancestral as well. They kept pretending to go for someone, Zarya or otherwise, and kept backing off, hoping to bait out an overly early ancestral healing. And yet, when it was finally needed, it was Mopsio and Anubarak, but he was too far. Rhaegar, he tried to get closer. Sulfurous Smash hits him, but it kind of hits him on the side. He tried to get closer, but he got rooted, so he could not save Anubarak. Very nice turn though, getting ETC there, making it a 1-for-1, and now they're starting to go back in again here. It's so nice to see Sonya again after so long and performing to such an admirable degree here in CQ.
She's still yet to die. She's tanked through everything here. I think she's the only... there is one other hero in this game who has not died, and it's currently Gran Paqueta on Malfurion. But the support versus the frontliner in terms of who's not died, Shihu's been doing a fantastic job. He's gone so sustainy with block, hurricane. In fact, I think he's got the exact build I did in the video yesterday. But either way, Nerves of Steel, that huge amount of extra tankiness, and Life Funnel. You were mentioning it earlier, the changes on Sonya's Whirlwind make her insanely tanky.
So nice. Block, healing, double Whirlwind, and Nerves of Steel. Maybe ignore pain at level 20. Could maybe go anger management, but I think it's probably not needed when you can already break out of roots. And here we go, Polska with another Punisher. It's an arcane one, and they're starting to take down the wall.
Wrath of the Berserker has fallen off, though. 30 seconds until it is back. He was not able to keep his Fury up to keep that active.
Very
not going to go any
result.
Deeper. They don't want to risk getting moshed here.
Very, very small result. You have a full HP Punisher. You're level 20 versus 20, and you only get a tower and half a gate. Anubarak was at the top getting XP, but I don't think it was really necessary. I think what you said is true. They were afraid of a marsh pit. It's such a concentrated, small little area. Trying to push through a gate is risky, but I still feel like Polska could have maybe got a little bit more out of it.
Yeah, I think so, but they're really trying to avoid just losing this game. This is the closest any team has come, I think, to trying to topple Zealot. They really don't want to throw this away. We'll see if they can keep it up. Right now, every player has level 20. ETC yet to pick his, but we have a heroic difficulty from Shad here. ETC into the backline. Sulfurous lands, but the mosh is interrupted. Shihul still taking through. Here comes the spin into the front line, going through everyone. And so is the Beatles. They already take down two heroes. It's a massacre by Polska. Pushing through, they want Zarmany, who's so tanky. The root will allow him to escape here.
It's a five-man root, thanks to that trail of Frost there, trying to body block Zarmany now. Anubarak, he's body blocking him. Zarmany goes down.
Beautifully done. They're wading through, ignoring any objectives, going straight for the keep. They think they can take it down. Beatles will tank for them if they can continue to activate them. Anubarak walks into the root. Totem is down. They're starting to run a bit long health point, continuing to micro beautifully to try and lower the health of the hero so they can't go for the core. In comes Anub. He's able to vault out the way of it. Grabbaketa keeping point topped up so he can do the damage. Shiku moving onto the core. He has so much sustain here. Can they do anything about this? Expulsion zone will try and keep point away. Gloomhammer with the huge shield thanks to Gain Train. They go for the core. all, Grubby. There's nothing that Zealots can do.
Yeah, another Storm Shield turned on here, preventing the core splash damage that could maybe take them out. They're going for it. The first loss to Team Zealot has been delivered by Polski Pamięta. What a game. Nubarak, Zarya, and Sonya. They did it. 1-0 in this best of three.
It happened. They can bleed. If they can bleed, we can kill it.
So good. They're not gods, Stetcher.
Oh my god, that was superb. Sonya, welcome back, friend. Shikul, really well played. Zero deaths that game. Malfurion was able to keep his zero deaths as well. But yeah. Absolutely beautifully played there.
Very, very impressive. And it's not even like Sonya's damage was that high. Overall, of course, she doesn't have like a long distance poke damage like Napalm Strike or Chromie Sandblast, so you're not gonna see her do 50, 60, 70k damage. The damage that she did do with Slam is fairly bursty, so when she moved in, it was relevant and most of all, extremely survivable. The most damage absorbed of any hero in this game. Once again, her talent pool is completely about self sustain, block, double whirlwind, ferocious healing, Nerves of Steel, ignore pain. And we could really feel that effect there in those final seconds.
She waded through there in the end. She got hit by Sulfurous. She got hit in the end, got cleansed out, and then just spun through. And that's it. There just was no CC left. She was able to wade all the way through, take all the damage. And with that, and a noob with the amazing body block on Arthas at the end, just able to secure the game.
Yeah, I think if they don't get Arthas there, they definitely can't end. So that was a very important moment. And just really good play by Razuf as well on Rhaegar. The cleanses, they were pinpoint precision. And even when they sometimes got mosh pit, they were able to stay alive thanks to Storm Shield as well. Even when cleanse and Ancestral were already gone. Yeah. Really cool game here.
Like, so many shields in that game. Shields on Anubarak, shields on Sonya, shields by Zarya, shields by Rhaegar. Only person who did it was Tychus.
Where's your shields, Tychus?
Yeah, Tychus, get it together.
No Neo Steel coating.
I just had the mental image of a Varian with twin blades and the shields burst ability. Just getting one shot. Absolutely beautiful.
Yeah. Well, Tychus went for a pretty cool build too. He went for the that's the stuff. Nice against double warrior. That's the stuff within the rhythm. So you increase the maximum duration of minigun every time that you minigun someone. There's double warrior, so he's gonna get a fairly good stacking there. And then with that's the stuff, that was his healing talent. And the Titan grenade as well at 16. So not getting that overkill build, instead getting that percentage based damage on the warriors. And his level 20 was sizzling attacks, another 1% extra bonus percentage based damage on basic attacks, even outside of minigun.
Wow, that was an insane game. That extra damage as well, just shredded through Arthas, even with his extra sustain. Invited you, by the way. For some reason, Shad is in the observer slot.
Sorry, Shad, you gotta sit this one out. It's almost like playing Apathur, right?
That's fair enough. That's a good shout. Oh dear. Guys, Apophis AFK in base report.
Oh, again.
Oh dear. Right, so ladies and gentlemen, second map going to be Dragonshire here.
Love it.
Gonna be honest, don't think it's as likely that we're going to see a Sonya again. Sonya's just so insane on the Infernal Shrines. The question is, was that the key catalyst to giving Polska the win over Zealots here? Or can they keep the streak going and make their way to the finals?
I feel like heroes like Zarya and Rhaegar, they can be played with varying degrees of proficiency, obviously, but it's pretty much their job to support, don't make any foolish overstepping and mistakes. The playmakers there is Anubarak and Sonya, and I think Sonya was a catalyst of that success. You pointed out never dying, that's great. And also Anubarak. It wasn't a flawless game by Mopsio, but he had really cool tricks, always coming in from the dark so that the burrow charge cannot easily be anticipated and dodged. And then some really high value damage and stuns. One more thing I wanted to point out, he went for Hive Master at level 20.
Yeah, I saw that.
One of my favorite talents. It's this beetle that does like 200-300 damage a pop like every few seconds, and it heals you for that amount as well. Pretty cool.
Yeah, it's a thing of just, I never need to go back to Fountain as long as I don't burn all my mana. It's a cool little thing.
guess not and a beetle, but a locust or something.
That's
but,
the one, yeah. So, starting off, welcome to the game number two draft. And standard bands, the Ragnaros and the Tassadar, and Zealots starting off with ETC.
Very excited to see what's coming out here from these teams. It's been a while since we've seen two very high-level teams here in HGC Europe Open Division play against each other on Dragonshire. We've seen a lot of other maps like Battlefield of Eternity, Infernal Shrines, and this is a complicated map. Laning setup is very important here, as if you either win the 1v1 or the 3v3 at bottom, we can call it a 4v4 depending on how the rotations go, you can pull the opponent out of position. You can start messing with their rotation, start getting the shrines and applying pressure. As soon as you control both lasers, they need to dedicate someone mid, and you simply don't. Like, yeah, you can try to get the Dragonite, but you don't need to. But the pressure is there for them to stop it, which means you can overpower them in a different lane and just do vanilla structural damage.
Yeah,
this is some cool heroes here. It's like Morales and Sergeant Hammer. We don't see them a lot on other maps.
Oh, God, yeah. This is something I mentioned in my videos, and I've heard you mention on stream as well. Getting the Dragonite is not the be-all end-all. Stopping them getting the Dragonite is the be-all end-all. As long as you're not doing other things, and they're focusing on trying to get the Dragonite, and you're not letting them, then you win the game. You just creep further and further ahead.
Yeah. You can, if you have that time, you either get a siege camp or a bruiser camp, or you just literally just whittle away at the opponent's towers. And for now, we don't see special quote-unquote Dragon Shire picks, save perhaps the Falstad. It's fairly meta. The Haka, actually, I think, is kind of under-prioritized here by these two teams. I would really expect to see him come out earlier.
Yeah, I can see that. It was the problem is that they didn't pick Mouth, then we probably would have seen him go with the ETC, because the CC lockdown is pretty incredible. But
could it have
Falstad,
been Mouth
I think
and
they
Dahaka?
Maybe could have swapped out, yeah.
I guess Falstad offers a little bit more control. There was already ETC, so you can have Gust to reset a potential mosh pit. Normally, I would say on Dragonshire, it's always stage dive for the control, for quickly swapping the shrine that you're at. But take a look at someone like Breeze from Fnatic. He'll almost always take Marsh Pit, even in stage dive, quote-unquote, situations, just because he wants to have a stronger team fight. So it's definitely important to continue to draft cancellations on Marsh Pit.
Yes, this is true. You can't assume it's going to be stage dive, even on a huge map like the Nukes. Which I got the name of the map. That's just completely gone from my head. Warhead Junction, there we go. Thank you, Brain, for shutting down.
Ooh.
Artanis. Cool. First time we've seen him today. He's still been fairly consistent in and out of the games throughout the entirety of the Open League, but sneaking in a little bit later here.
Okay, Artanis. So we've got the swap into the roots, into Gust potential for isolation. Of course, it's not the only way that you can use it. It's just really solid all-around hero. What else are they going to pair it with?
We will see. Meridian, double tank straight away.
Now, Artanis can solo lane. His best solo laning talent at level 4 is Shield Battery, even though it doesn't get a lot of love. It's actually fairly solid. You don't need it for solo laning, though. If you play it well, you will get continuous shields when you take poke damage, and you'll pretty much stay fairly healthy.
Yeah, it's a good talent. Shield Burn, I think we saw it with, but we've seen it in a lot of team fight compositions in some of the other games, but most teams still seem to stick with Shield Surge due to it being good, even though it was nerfed recently.
Yeah, 10% off, 85. It used to be extra 85, now it's 75. I guess it's not really technically 10% off, but anyway, it's a 1 and a 0 has disappeared from that number.
Makes sense. Dragonshire, next two picks. They have a kinda global in ETC.
So they still need a solo pick. It can be something like Thrall, Chen, Alarak. People sometimes ask, what constitutes a good solo laner? Well, self-sustain, decent wave clear.
Lovely solo laner. And so is the Auric. Okay, why have one when you could have two?
Zul is a fantastic solo laner, but it's like employing a horse to carry a satchel. Or a purse. He can do better than that. He can do a horse race, you know. And Zul, he can race two lanes down without any help, get all the XP and deplete ammunition of the opponent. That's what he is. He's a dual laner, we call it. Leoric,
yeah,
he is more of a solo laner. So expect Leoric top, which means that we need a counter to him here in Polska Pamięta. Who would they go for? Thrall is okay. Artanas can solo lane against him, but it's actually a losing matchup. He clears weaker, yeah, and he takes too much damage from the healing.
Banner. Okay, how does he sneak through? Which casting is Zealot? How does he get through so far?
That's true.
So they picked up there. That's fair enough. Valor, they have the two range damage, two frontliners. Fine, just a good old-fashioned double tank, double damage support comp.
Isn't it funny that the first time we see Zealot lose is the first time they do not go for, oh, let's just go for our favorites, Rhaegar, Tyrael,
yeah,
Valor.
They didn't have Tass or Tyrael because they banned out one and got the other one picked away.
Hmm. Yeah.
Ooh. Maybe we found...
They're coming apart at the seam, Stitcher.
Oh no, they've forgotten how to draft up. This is a disaster.
It is a different map, and this should be... let's see. Whose pick is this?
I don't know who picked first, so I can't
see. It was ETC first.
Oh. So yeah, in theory it should be...
Polska's pick.
Polska's, yeah.
Okay. It's not like loser's pick.
I think so. Yeah, that would make sense.
Here on the right side, in the red, it's going to be Polska Pamięta. They're up 1-0 in the semifinals of HGC Cup 2. And they're in the red here. Razuf is on Malfurion, Mapsio on Muradin, Potiboss is on Artanas, Sihu on Vala, and Gluhammer on Falstad.
On the right hand, on the left hand side, it's going to be the blue team of Zealots, our first cup winner, but currently 0-1 down in this series. Gran Paqueta on Rhaegar, Puig on the Tychus, Shad on Leoric, Zabadi on Zul, and a Pharaoh Angel on ETC. The double golden chicken.
Very nice. Gluhammer starting to take a forward positioning using his fly, getting a bit of bonus damage. And most of all, you get that vision to see if someone is approaching this brush here.
Yeah. Big group up in the bot lane right now. Four heroes down here. We called this a bit earlier. We'll see who, if anyone, rotates down here.
Why is Rhaegar standing exactly here? Why not one step to the left or bottom? He seems very pleased with his position. He's not moving.
He liked it. It's fine. But they're going to be able to push that up super easily. Oh, a four-back rotation. 4v4, level one. Let's go. Zhu focus down. He's gone. A Pharaoh Angel trying to wade through this. He wants Mopsio. But a Pharaoh Angel has to back up due to being low health. Mopsio misses the person standing still with Perfect Storm. And as such, does not gain a stack.
Oh, ruined.
Yeah, it is Perfect Storm level 1, by the way, in case you missed that. We have Backlash on Zul, the extra 15% maximum health damage once the after a couple seconds. And it is going to be the Prog Rock on ETC. Falsed, Golden Fortis, Seasoned Marksman. ETC going to get complete, not denied actually, gets a follow-up on Mopsio. But Tychus not using the minigun.
Had Mopsio not cast that Stormbolt on Ethereal Angel's face, he would not have gotten 5 damage boost on his quest. No, what I mean is he would have not saved Vala. Vala would have died to the power slide, most likely, of Ethereal Angel. It was a fast reaction by Mopsio, well done.
Yep, was very impressive. Moonburn, by the way, also on Malfurion, helping him clear the lane, but he can't do a huge amount against this really aggressive roam. Mopsio getting double CC'd here. There's the slow by Gran Paqueta here. So much focus. Mopsio is just going to tank it. Nope, jumps over the wall, saves himself. Zarmony focus, dropping low, keeps himself alive. And Schickle just surviving the grenade as well. But both objectives currently in favor of Zealots. If they can hold bot, which looks unlikely right now because they just rotated too quickly, they might have been able to get the DK. But either way, Zealots, with their rotation, very aggressive. Lots of damage coming out.
And it all started with that beginning, right? You'd like to have this comfortable 4v4 rotation, like in Tomb of the Spider Queen. And it seems like it is kind of similar. Okay, both maps have a 4-man rotation to mid and bottom. But it works out so differently because of the terrain. The shortest route is through the middle, and it's a pretty long route to go safely here on the right side. So actually being efficient means being stronger in this neutral terrain here, and right from the get-go, Zealot started controlling it with that 4-man power slide. Kind of a mistake, you would say, by Polska. They didn't see anyone on the map early on, and they got ganked there.
Yeah, possibly. Bit of a scuffle in the bottom lane over this objective. Gluhammer denying Zarmony the Dragon Knight for the moment. But Poik doing a lot of harassment. They're going after Muradin again. And Falstad actually being out-damaged by Zarmony pretty well here. This may not go well. Zealots may be able to cap this.
Yeah, the cool thing about the way that Zul was playing it, he pushed the lane so far that the minion archers... Hold that thought, Siku! Oh, 1%. The minion archers were attacking Gloomhammer, even as they are now. In order to interrupt, Gloomhammer is taking continuous poke damage from the minions. Yeah. And that's actually a really cool new perspective to the matchup Zul versus Falstad. Because normally Falstad should be able to dominate him. He shouldn't even take a single hit, as Zul doesn't have any mobility talents.
Yeah, he does have a hammer gains though. Falstad able to sustain himself at least a little bit. A Feral Angel getting focused down once again. But able to survive through this point, was also not able to get Strickle here. And once again, the objective, bottom objective at least, will go over to Zealots, but top objective has finally been taken by Polti Boss, and Shad in some trouble here. Gloomhammer has flown up, they're going to try and get him here, but Wraith Walk, he's out of here, the flip just misses. Cool move.
Now, if Artanis did that perfectly, Leoric almost cannot dodge, because the place where he comes out is pretty much predictable, but it was that sidestep, it was that 0.1 second off. Still pretty cool move here by him and Falstad.
Yeah, it is a cool move indeed. Once again, both objectives currently held by Team Zealots and Gloomhammer, being forced into this top bush once again. But with Hammer Gates, he's pretty sustained at the moment. He's going to be able to clear this up pretty nicely. But bot lane for Polska, having a little bit of trouble here. Also, quick point out here, Lingering Apparition by Leoric instead of the Paralyzing or the extra the Ghastly Reach.
Okay. And no hardened bones, so he just wants to remain unstoppable for a very long period of time. I guess it kind of makes sense. If he gets swapped, he wants to make it all the way back to his own back line, not just a few steps away.
Yeah, makes sense. Gloomhammer coming in from above. He wants Zarmody here. Zarmody popping the bone shield, keeping himself alive. Good block by Poik, preventing Zarmody from getting stunned out. And he was cleansed, so he didn't go down himself. Gloomhammer getting focused. The heal from Zhuv is not enough. And that is a second kill going over to Zealots, 2-0 currently.
Yeah, very nice. Bigger they are on Poyok. At level 4, 40% is where a hero will remain after he finishes his minigun. That's what they did on Falstad. Power Slide came up and they got the takedown. And that's 2-0 in takedowns for Team Zealot.
Yeah, but even with a hero down, they weren't able to grab the DK. Polti Boss reacting quickly, able to grab control of that top area before it did go down. Right now, though, Shad is going for it. We're going to see a bit of a 1v1 here. Polti Boss losing positioning a couple times, losing a couple shots, but Gloomhammer coming in. They once again want the kill, and even if they don't get it, they will force Shad away from this and make sure that this objective doesn't go over to Zealots.
The main problem here for Polska Pimienta is that Zul's push mid lane has been devastating. It removed the ammunition during... Gloomhammer!
Bye! Punished. They know exactly where he keeps going every time.
I wonder if maybe he could have tried to barrel bottom right through the terrain.
Maybe? It would have been towards Mopsio. Might have been able to get the CC, but hindsight's 2020.
Well, Zul has been doing a lot of damage here mid lane. And they don't really have someone to clear it easily if they don't send Mal for Vala. Falstad doesn't clear as well as those two. He's even he does have Boomerang now, so that will help. But the towers are gone, and the Dragonite goes to Team Zealot with their level 10 advantage.
Yeah, and with no towers, if they push with this, they can just go straight into the fort here and try and take this down for a really early bit of XP boost. They already have their heroics, so they could have fought with this Dragonite, but instead, they're just using it for poke damage right now while all of the other lanes are being pushed. We have a three-man push in the bot lane. Schickle, nice vault there, able to keep himself alive and get a little bit of poke damage. And the DK going straight into the fort, kicking away Falstad to begin pushing that lane.
I want to talk a little bit about what the Dragonite is doing here. If there's no immediate action, why is he staying mid? People might be wondering, why isn't he hitting buildings and just going for minions? Hold that thought. Big move here, Twilight Dream to cancel out the Entomb combo there on Malfurion. So they baited that out. Entomb is now 40 seconds away. They baited out Twilight Dream. Mopsio trying to get away. He gets cleansed, which means he can Dwarf Toss. There's this really cool interplay of Murden ETC, where Murden tries to Dwarf Toss away, but the Power Slide or Face Melt will cancel it. So Ruzuf allowed him to use it within a second grace period by cleansing him before anything even happened. And luckily, Mopsio noticed it in time.
Yeah, it was cool to see. He was able to jump away. Communication, very key here. Mopsio, bit of harassment, wants to get up to Othero, but here comes Shad. Mopsio, aggressive jump over the wall. Always jumping in that downwards direction, where this time he didn't really have anyone to punish him if he went up.
Now, the Dragonite again. Why did the Dragonite not hit the fort often enough? I'm providing an argument here where using the Dragonite draws away resources forced to defend it so that you can do more damage in a different lane. but I don't think it worked out exactly for them. They didn't do too much in the bottom hole. They thought mosh pit, and there we go.
Beautiful
with the mighty
gust and the suppression pulse lands as well on all the heroes that were gusted away, buying them a little bit more time. They get the stun and the hammerang on to Poik here, who's being chased back with Mopsio, now being shredded. The entomb is dropped, but there's no combo off it here. Podimos doing huge damage. Ancestral keeps Zarmony alive though. Now it's just Shad. Wraith walk away. He does go down, not able to teleport in time. And that is the first kill that Polska have been able to get.
Very nice for them. 3-2-1. They started. Oh, yes. Okay, so we were informed of this. There's a little bit of technical issues predicted and informed that may affect Ruzaf. And it would take a few minutes to settle in the meantime.
Could either be a slight internet issue or his apartment complex has been having slight power issues. He informed the admins in time. He has a key to reset everything. So he's going to be sorting that as quick as possible. Everyone's been informed. Everything is fine.
Yeah, this is such a heads up, nice way of preparing administrators, fans and viewers, and us casters. We know this is going to happen. It sucks. It's technical issues. But at least we inform you so that you know what's happening.
Yeah, because we have experienced what happens when a power cut, an unexpected power cut, hits at an inopportune time in the qualifiers, where another Polish team, Juve, had a power cut and he wasn't able to reconnect in time. And as such, the enemy team were just claimed the victory because it was going on for too long.
Yeah, it's
Juve,
unfortunate.
Though, he knows it's happening, he's prepared, he's done an incredible job of it, and is managing to disconnect multiple times.
He's left the game 3 times now. There goes Sihu, Juve's story once again.
Yeah.
Do you think that Team Zealot got enough out of the Dragon Knight? I get what they're trying to do, but
I don't think so, actually. Like, I understand, like, I 100% agree with you with what they tried to do, but I don't think they were able to do it well enough. They were able to get a lot of towers, but I really think the Dragonite could have at least burned a little bit of health in the mid lane. But he was against Falstad, though. That is the issue.
So
even
if you
burned a little bit of health, Falstad could have gusted him and killed him.
If you remember, it was 1-1-3. Dragonite mid, they put Leoric top and 3 bottom. It's not the kind of distraction that I'm usually talking about, where you send Dragonite top, and it looks like the game is suddenly... What?
Yep. No one asked for the ready there. So
someone accidentally unpaused. Okay.
Yep, that's fine. But looks like Shuf is back.
If you put Dragonite in the top, someone hit the keyboard with the headset. Oops. Okay. And of course, Juve is not back because it's not Juve that we're waiting for.
Shuf.
But you're ready. Oh well, let's just go back. If you put 1 in the top lane and 4 in the bottom, then and the 1 in the top lane is Dragonite, you will get siege damage north or south.
Yeah,
but they did the 1-1-3. When he kicked Falstad and landed up next to the fort, I get trying to get away to save HP on the Dragonite, but forts no longer slow attack speed of Dragonite. So you're right next to it, and you momentarily kicked away the only defender. He should have absolutely hit that fort, in my opinion, Zarmony there on the Dragonite, and get it down to half life, 20% life. Of course, they had an option to do some damage in the bot lane, but it didn't really work out.
Yeah, it was a good attempt, but not able to get it to really work out in their favor. But looks like we're just waiting for Shad to return. He decided to use this time to quickly have a bio break. But some of the other talents we have not actually talked about yet. Follow through coming in on the Artanis here, as opposed to the extra attack speed or the slow, which I guess is just to help him lane against the Auric, just get that extra single target damage.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty cool. Didn't go for the shield battery, Artanis.
Yeah, the shield surge, still good. Even though he's solo lane, he knows he has to team fight at some point.
Yeah. I guess even in the solo lane, getting a bigger shield against Leoric's drain will actually save more HP than potentially shield battery.
Does make sense quite a bit. And Zul, he's gone full skeletons here for now. He's gone the Trag Owl's Essence and Rathma's Blessing here. So he's got the extra healing, extra mana. He's basically, as long as he has minions around, he's going to be sustained.
I wonder sometimes what builds are still possible for Zul. He's got that 40% baseline slow on his sweeping strikes, and he can upgrade it to 75% attack speed slow. But he hasn't gotten it. It does require you to sacrifice that healing on the Skeletal Warrior. It's a tough choice. It's nice to go for that, but he's already fairly vulnerable usually, isn't he?
He has one talent, though, that I think is going to help out significantly here. With the double front line, the Artanis and the Muradin, he does have a Titan Killer talent, is what it's called, which basically means that his sweep, his cleaving attack, will do percentage damage.
Yeah, that one comes at level 13.
Yes.
That one is pretty strong, and it's contested by picks that aren't as... important, I suppose. Let's see, he's got the Giant Killer at 13. He's got Skeletons that explode, which is kind of cool if you fight in lane, but not everyone always does, per se. It would be a map for it, though. So I guess we'll see what he will exactly go at level 13.
Exactly. So excited to see. We're approaching level 13 for both teams slightly quicker. For Zealots, they've been able to get a couple more kills and some nice tower murderization for their side. They're out positioned nicely, but pretty much just a scout he's going to have to pull back. And this does reveal Grandpa Care to go for the Merc Camps. Are they going to contest this? Looks like they are. Mopsio moving in. Ponty has come all the way down as well. They're going for Poik once again. He's forced to back up, and they're able to steal the camp. And that's all they really came for. The kill on Poik would have just been a bonus.
I thought they came for a Theora Angel, and he showed them the camp.
This is true. But the second they knew it was there, it was immediately about, well, we can steal this. Yeah. Not a huge amount of effort. We know Leo is top, and it works out for them. Once again, Zul bullying Gloomhammer out of lane, but we're going to see the four-man in the bot lane coming out of Polska to be able to capture that objective, and with this mercenary camp, they're just going to ignore top, and they're just going to push down this bot lane.
Okay, so they will lose a tower or two slowly, but strength in numbers with four members here. They've got kill potential as soon as Artanis does a swap. Zul is still delaying his level 13 choice. He will go for that Giant's Curse, 2% maximum health.
That's what it's called. Mopsio is interrupted in the jump. He's rooted, but no follow-up for it here. And Shad has come down. Falstad's not here to help out. Entomb lands on Schickel here, and in comes the Skeletons. Even Cleanse can't help you with that. Actually, no, he's going to get out of here. Who survives this? Zarmadi is going to be able to capture this altar here. But Gloomhammer is coming down. He's going to find Shad with his face, but he's going to be able to pull back and not take too much damage.
There was a really nice maximum distance in Tomb on Zihu, but they were unable to confirm the kill. Zul goes down. He's got moments where he can do something when he has the shield. When he doesn't have the bone armor, it's pretty difficult for him.
He's completely surrounded. There's the Gust. Somebody, the Rain of Vengeance catches everyone there. We've already seen ETC go down. Grand Paqueta goes down too. Can they get Poik? They don't have the flip. Either way, they currently have both shrines, and we're seeing two heroes heading up to the mid lane. Shad, yes, he's got a lot of sustain, but he can't hold this out forever. Mopsio going to try and zone him out here, and that's going to be the second Dragonite of the game going over to Polska. 1-1 so far in terms of objectives.
Yes, and this one should do far more than previous Dragonite so far. Not only are there few defenders, but it's also a higher level Dragonite, and it does massive damage on fortifications. In the meantime, pushing at the bottom as well. Approaching level 16 further and further.
Yep, sneaking towards it, and with all these towers getting killed off, you can see Gloomhammer focusing down towers here, giving his team the easy XP as opposed to putting his team in danger. He's taken a lot of damage from Shad, though. That percentage damage, very effective on the Dragonite. Gloomhammer getting focused, and this Dragonite going to go down way before the duration runs out. Going to kick Poik out the way, though, so if they do want to fight this is actually a really reasonable time. Athero does have Mosh available, though, and as such, it's a disengage from Polska. Oh, but the Skeletons, they still want to go for it. Schickel getting focused down. Do they have Cleanse available? Yes, they do, and Schickel is immediately out.
Entomb, Sihu. Is there anyone to follow him up? There goes Suppression Pulse. That's a great counter to Entomb follow-up damage. There's a lot of auto-attack damage coming out of Team Zealot here. Yeah. And now the turnaround, the swap on Zul.
Ancestral is good. Zarmadi surviving. He's wading through. The mosh pit interrupted after going off with the full cooldown. Zarmadi focused down the beautiful gust by Gloomhammer. Now they're trying to get Poik, but he's too far away. They're really zoned out from any retreat here. Here comes ETC. They're able to get Valor here. The mistake of the positioning by Polska. They turn it around, though. Get two more heroes. This is a 3-for-2 currently, but they want more. Mopsio wading through. It's two tanks and a healer versus two tanks. They want Shad. It's the slowest fight ever. Shad is able to escape.
Man, the Bruiser Camp waking up there and starting to kill Falstad.
Yeah, they got it. That was weird. That was weird but fun.
A weird fighting position too. We basically have Polska Pimienta chasing through a mid fort, which isn't even dead, all the way to the top fort. Pretty crazy stuff there, but they get the 3-for-2, which is kind of crazy when you consider how the fight went.
Yeah, it's impressive that they really got away with that as well as they did. Very nicely done.
And Twilight Dream missed everything. I've even been having my doubts about whether Twilight is the choice here. Most Twilight Dreams have not been very effective. He got ETC and Leoric in the second to last fight. In the last fight, he got nobody. And the one time where he could have had an amazing one, where we had the triple gust here, Twilight Dream was not available anymore. And I just wonder, okay, Tranquility last choice by Team Zealot. I think it was a good choice. They lost anyway. But would it have been good here against Double Warrior? On the other hand, Dragon Trail is such an extended laning phase where basically you can barely afford to Hearthstone for lack of doing something in the lane. Twilight Dream does give you more mana regen, so that is definitely something to be considered. Ether Angel with the defensive flank.
Yeah, he doesn't have much. 12 seconds for that. Skeletons have been used by Zul. Cleanse has to be used on Mopsio, as he takes a lot of damage here, having to pop back. Remember, he is Muradin. As such, he has pretty decent self-regen, so he will be available for the fight again. Falstad, already able to grab mid. Looks like he's going to top. He looks like he may go grab mid. He could try Gust Shad here, try and get up here, but bot has been lost. But now they're trying to focus onto Zarmani. Root lands onto the Artanis here, but Mopsio in the background just ruining Zarmani's day. Shichul, though, completely left alone here, barely survives, but Zul is killed off.
That was a very late ancestral healing. That damage was a while in
the
making.
Oh, there we go.
That's a pretty decent Twilight Dream. Getting the damage on Poyok, Ethereal Angel as well. And it does look like the champions of Cup number one, the prospective champions of Cup number two here, are getting defeated. It's 1-0 and Polska Pimenta gets the triple kill and it should secure the Dragonite. And Tetcher, that represents a keep at this point.
Yes, it does. They could easily wade through mid if they want to, or rotate to bot. They have both of those options available to them. Looks like mid is going to be the choice because it's free. It's got so little health, and then wade down to bot where the rest of the team is already positioned. That's going to be a huge amount of XP for them. But yeah, beautiful play. And that last gust, a little bit unnecessary, but it got the job done. Able to kill off ETC, who will have Mosh when he's alive again. But so far, these Moshes, no value, and that's a huge amount to do with Falstad.
Yep, the interrupts have just been too fast. Every member has an interrupt here on Team Polska, Pamięta. So the stage dive, maybe it would have been nice. Moshpit gets a bio, but anyway, they're going straight for the core. Level 20 is on the horizon here, Tetcher.
Into once again used on Shekel, who is burst down. Gloohammer killed out of this Dragonite eventually, but the core's already on 40% health. The Dragonite goes down. Moshpit interrupted. Gust to try and disengage, but it's too late. Core goes down, and that is GG. And it's going to be Polska Pamięta moving on to the grand finals, Grubby.
So well played. They do it 2-0, they do it in style. Really impressed here by Polska Pamięta. I hadn't really heard of them, their team name, until now, but I have seen them play and I'm impressed. And it means that they will go to the finals. We will go to the second semi-finals first, and then we'll see who actually comes up against them. For now, a quick score and talent review. Very few deaths here on the side of Polska Pamięta. Muradin and Artanis, in fact, never died, which is pretty impressive considering they're the double warrior against against the Tychus and the Leoric, basically the best warrior killers in the game. Their talents: triple strike, titan killer, follow through, shield surge, reactive parry. Muradin has gone for that mana reduction talent on perfect storm, bit of extra damage, thunderburn, and impressively he's gone for imposing presence at level 16. Highly unusual considering reverberation, basically Thunderclap itself, I suppose, already does an attack speed and a movement speed slow. So there's a kind of overlap here for Muradin in that sense. But still, this is a bigger radius, especially when using the activatable. And it apparently it's worth it, he says, with the rewind eventually. Nice finish there by Polska Pamięta. They will be 2-0.
Furious Smash has not been used. Zarmani getting chased all the way back. To Furious Smash doesn't stun anyone. It does a lot of damage. The Gust for the disengage, though. Marginehi is getting strafed. He's taking huge damage. He's able to retreat and stays himself, keeps himself alive. Ethereal Angel, though, trying to give his team a chance to re-engage. Tuluf taking a lot of damage. Where's the stun? He's cleansed out of it, but the damage is still very high. Tuluf already dropping low. There's the root. Can they finish off Ethereal? Even if they do, he's dead.
Tuluf,
he's healed up.
No!
The Garrigan coming in. Bloodlust is used. The Ice Block is used. And Zarmani getting focused down. Punished for your greediness, sir. But the Punisher goes over to Zealots.